last year, I put a bunch of musicians, friends of mine, on the spot and asked them to write songs or do some of my favorite songs of theirs. And they survived it. They actually enjoyed it, some of them. And they're willing to do it again. And I decided, how am I going to raise the bar? Well, I invited even other people that inspire me, and let's do this. So to my furthest right, Steve Wynn. Yay. Yay. Steve and I met when he was in the Dream Syndicate in 1983. And
well done.
Thank you. We worked together when he was signed to A&M Records. And in fact, the only song that I have ever written in my life was called While I Was Breaking Your Record, You Were Breaking My Heart. And that was written about you and Peter Buck when you were on that tour together. That went well. All good. Since you broke my heart, what have you been doing?
Since that.
Since 1984.
I've never been asked that question before. For a few more years after breaking your heart and you breaking our record, the Dream Syndicate lasted until 88. And since that time, I've been making records under my own name as a solo artist, as Steve Wynn, and Steve Wynn and the Miracle Three, my band I have now, and also playing with various side projects like the Baseball Project with some buddies from REM and my wife, Linda Pittman, on drums, played with a band called Gutterball throughout the 90s, and just in the last few years reunited the Dream Syndicate, so all those things.
Is there a Danny and Dusty reunion?
There actually was.
There was?
We did one record and a tour of Europe, two tours of Europe about 5 years ago.
Nice.
It was fun.
And seriously, if you don't recognize this guy, then you only own Captain and Tennille Records. or maybe you could have both, but the man who needs no introduction is Bob Mould. And you've been busy lately?
Yeah, it's been a busy decade, feels like. But yeah, the last few years have been real busy, very, very, a lot of very fortunate things have been bestowed upon me, the Disney Hall tribute, the Sugar reissues, very, very nice reaction to the Silver Age album that came out a couple of years ago.
You wrote a book.
I wrote a book, yeah, that was, that was a lot of work. That was harder than a song. And then Workbook reissue just came out a few weeks ago, and a new album coming out in June, so yeah, super busy, thanks.
And then a repeat panelist, Matthew Caws from Not a Surf and Minor Alps. And you as well have been traveling around the world.
We Not a Surf took a break after 20 years, and I wanted to stay busy, so yeah, I made a record with Juliana Hatfield. We were called Minor Alps, and did one tour, going to do one more tour, and then getting Not a Surf going again next week. And then I also almost finished a record with Michael Lerner from Telekinesis. And we don't have a name yet, so if you've got a great one that you're sitting on that you might not use, please please come see me and I will ply you with whatever you like, any snacks from outside or whatever you want. Free tickets forever. So yeah, really excited about that, and then just getting going again with my day job.
Which is not a surf.
Which is not a surf, yeah.
Nice day job. And
yeah.
Then Austin's finest, although where do you live now? I mean, you coming back to L.A.?
Austin.
You're not coming back?
I don't know. I don't know what I'm doing.
Okay. A repeat. Britt is my go-to for all things panel related, and sometimes reluctantly, and sometimes he just feels sorry for me. So Britt Daniel from Spoon. And Divine Fits, and you're looking at a man who just finished his record on Monday, the new Spoon record. So, and I referred to it as, I'm not gonna even say what I called it, but there's this the period of time between a record is finished and then people start to hear it.
What How do you call that?
I called it the pregnancy.
Between when you finish it and when it comes out?
Yeah.
Okay.
The All pregnancy.
Right. All right.
Yeah.
Everybody's excited.
Everybody's excited. You got a little bit of nausea.
Right, and then comes the postmortem.
Maybe your ankles are swollen a little bit. When I was pregnant, my kid loved Black Like Me. That was his jam. And I was at a rehearsal with Spoon before we were playing the Hollywood Bowl. And he just would kick like crazy during that. Even now at 5, he totally digs that song. That's his favorite Spoon song.
Cool.
And wait till you see him sing it. Anyway, so you're at this interesting period where people are just starting to hear it and you're starting to formulate the plan. And there's got to be the exhaustion of having just put your heart and soul into something. And then how are you feeling right now?
I feel good. I mean, it was a pretty intense record-making process, like I guess they pretty much always are. And so for it to be 3 days done feels pretty insane. Feels pretty great. I feel real good about the record, and you know, it was fun to make, but I'm kind of glad to be past it.
Yeah, well, I'll get back to, I have a couple of questions about that. And then a new one to the panel, a relatively new artist, but one that is receiving a lot of acclaim, and I first heard about from a mutual friend to all of us. The person who inspired this panel is my friend Dan Wilson, who's now making a living as a songwriter, having done the Trip Shakespeare and then Semisonic. And he's won a couple of Grammys for Dixie Chicks and for Adele, and that's what he does now. He's a collaborator, and both Matthew and Britt have worked with him. And it's just a different way of thinking about approaching a song is when you're doing it in a collaborative way. But I first heard about Jeremy Messersmith from Dan, and he's to my furthest left, and he's a new addition to the panel. And we're very excited to have him here. He's been hearing all our war stories.
Mainly, I've just been stealing songwriting tips from everybody on this panel, so thank you.
Well, so Britt, before we start, there's going to be performances, of course, because we only give you the best. Oh, and I'm Karen Glauber, I'm president of Hits Magazine, and for some reason, I don't know why I agreed to do this however many years ago, I get records played on the radio. It's one of the worst jobs ever, because you deal with really stupid people that don't like music. But when it works, it's the most amazing thing. When you hear a song that you're passionate about, and for me, it's been Arcade Fire and Tame Impala and Spoon, definitely Not a Surf, etc. It's just the most magical feeling in the world, because then it's sort of, that's still the number one way to reach an audience is on the radio. So I've tortured myself with that for 32 years. So Britt, question for you.
Yeah.
So last time we were here, it was during the Divine, right when the Divine Fits record was coming out, and that had been a collaborative process. Were you more open to collaboration on this record?
I guess so.
Did you work with any, was it a different mindset that it's now Spoon is?
I think so. I mean, I think that, I mean, I've always wanted it to be as collaborative as possible, but I think that I did pick up some perspective and some tricks by working with new people, mm-hmm. you know? And Dan's a great songwriter from Divine Fits, and so he was writing half the songs on the record, and that was a new experience for me. I mean, on this record,
Do you have any co-writes?
Jim and Eric from Spoon wrote the music to one of the songs.
Oh, great.
So. That hasn't been done before.
So you were open to that?
I am.
Wow. This is good. And any other outside? Did you try writing with other people?
Yeah, I wrote with your friend Dan Wilson.
My friend Dan Wilson.
I brought We tried to write a song kind of from scratch. That didn't work so good. Well, we never finished it. I guess I shouldn't say it didn't work good. We just never finished it. And then I brought him one that was almost finished, and he helped me finish it. Helped me finish it. Helped me arrange some chords and figure out some words that were tricking me.
And what about you? You just did a record with Juliana.
Yeah.
And you've been working with Michael. Is that a different mindset than working with Not a Surf? Or is it the same well?
No. Well, it's the same well, but it's a different mindset for sure. And I guess in a similar way to what you just said, Britt, now Not a Surf just started working together again 2 weeks ago, and we're about to really get going. And I think I learned a lot about perspective, because with Juliana, we had exactly the same role. And I realized that there were times in Not a Surf when I was making more decisions than perhaps I needed to, just because I thought no one else was going to, you know. But then working with Juliana, I was working with someone who was ready to shoot down anything, or not, you know. But she wasn't gonna let anything go just because, you know, even though it's a democracy, I'd sort of come to a position where my vote counts heavily. So it's been great, actually, because then we got together with Not a Surf, and I was really just much more open. I mean, I've always tried to be, you know, but some of these patterns can be accidental, you know. So I think it was, I'm really happy, and it's been wonderful to work with other people, and also kind of shed some inhibitions, because it's hard to lyrics are just, I find them difficult, and to kind of bury yourself in front of somebody, and you got to go through the stupid lines to get to the good ones. You got to say like three dumb things, and I've become slowly less embarrassed about that.
Yeah. Steve, when you started, I mean, you came from college radio. Had you already started, writing songs when you were in college? Was that part of the Dream Syndicate formed when you were in college, right?
Actually, Dream Syndicate formed, yeah. Well, I guess while I was still in college, but I was writing songs and playing in bands since I was 9, so I did it pretty early on.
What are some of the writers that...
I don't do those songs now, though.
What?
I take it back. The first song I wrote when I was 9 years old, I have played acoustic shows now, and it's not bad.
Really?
Yeah. For a 9-year-old,
what's it called?
It's called Sing My Blues. I was a very depressed 9-year-old. Not a bad song. Yeah, it wasn't about my pretty pony, or, you know, my red bicycle, or, you know, my puppy Joe. It was Sing My Blues.
How about you, Bob? What was the first song you wrote?
When I was 9, it was called Let Me Live Today, Lord, Let Me Live Today. And
Jeremy,
it worked.
Your first song?
This explains a lot.
Your first song?
I don't actually remember the title of it, but it was a story song about somebody who has some sort of like athlete's foot and is talking to a psychiatrist about it. I don't know. It was weird.
Wow, that was pretty complex.
I thought it was really deep at the time when I was maybe like 9 or 10.
Athlete's foot was sort of the limit of how your lexicon of diseases. That was
maybe so. I hadn't been exposed to much medical malady at that point.
Yeah. Yeah. Britt, do you remember?
Oh, I had a song called Sweeping the Floor. I think that's the first one.
And
probably about 8 or 9.
And you, Matthew?
It's called Weatherman, about not wanting to be a weatherman. Which now I realize...
Was anyone forcing you to be a weatherman?
No. It was just about, what, you know, when I needed money, what was I going to do? I hope I didn't have to do that. But now I realize that's a pretty good gig, so I take it back.
Yeah. I almost wrote a song... actually, like a couple months ago, called Weather Boy. I just like the idea of.
Does a weather boy become a weatherman? Do they have?
Well,
to
I thought it was like it would be
storms?
Like it would be like a Broadway thing or something where it's like every weatherman needs a weather boy. You know, it's like a Robin thing or something.
Relatable, really, completely relatable. And Bob, you've been in so many different bands and different things, and one of the things we were talking about earlier was we were talking about your new record, and I asked you about my favorite ever Husker Du song, which is Hardly Getting Over It. Mm-hmm. And it was fascinating that you said one of your new songs is almost like an answer to that,
to the questions,
to the question that you asked.
The song Hardly Getting Over It, I wrote that in 85. I was 25 years old. And you know, it was my first you know, song, I guess, where, you know, it was very clearly about mortality and what do you do when, you know, at the time when your grandparents pass, and, you know, most recently when a parent passes. And it's a, you know, it's a really simple song. And you were talking about how the title, you know, those four words.
Yeah, one of the things we're talking about is like how certain phrases not only inform an entire song, but that becomes, you know, almost a catchphrase or almost something that provides comforters. I mean, one of the things I was saying is like, because I have no knowledge about anything except music, that I tend to think in other people's song lyrics. Like that's what occurs to me. It's not any other work of art. It's not a movie reference. I can't quote Caddyshack, but I can do, like, I can reference song lyrics. And so when that song really was helpful for me when my mother was dying, and would you sing it? Would
sure.
You perform
let
it?
Me, let me find a guitar.
There's a couple up there.
Yeah. Okay. Sure. I was all self-conscious when I saw these and I had this. Right. So,
yeah, so.
Whatever you prefer, I think.
Yeah, I got some. Oh my gosh, it's got, I can plug it in and everything. Okay. Who's, is this your son?
Yeah.
Do
yeah.
I just turn it on?
It should be on. Can I give it a, yeah.
Let's try sitting. I haven't sat on a stool and played in forever. Oh my gosh, is this, oh, is that a good balance? Is that 50-50? Okay. Is this on?
It is on. You hear a guitar out there?
No.
All right.
Okay, cool. It's good. 20 years ago, saw a friend was walking by. I stopped him on the street to ask him how it went, and all he did was cry. I looked him in the face, I couldn't see past his eyes. I asked him what the problem was, here's your disguise. Said I'm hardly getting over it, hardly getting used to getting said I'm hardly getting over it, hardly getting used to getting by and I. Old man who lays down by the railroad tracks. Got no paper on his pocket, got no paper on his back. I asked him what the time was, so hit the road now, Jack. I went back to see him next week, died of a heart attack and died away. And now I'm hardly getting over it, hardly getting used to getting by. I'm hardly getting over it, hardly getting used to getting by. And Grandpa had a seizure, moved into a hotel cell, and died away. My parents, they just wonder when they both are gonna die. Said I'm hardly getting over it, hardly getting used to getting mad. Oh yeah. Said I'm hardly getting over it, hardly getting used to getting by. Repeats of the solo. Fanfare at the end.
So, Bob, do you want to do your new one that's the answer, or do you want to wait a minute?
Oh, let me wait a minute.
Wait a minute. That was, by the way, I'm...
Clear the deck.
I'm just like, I'm dying right now. That's my favorite. I have to hug you. Like... That's the power of song. It's just mind's blown. It's just incredible. Hi, Britt.
Hey.
You ready?
When we do a song?
And here's okay. So, I have a question, and then you do a song. One of the things you asked me a while ago, besides my 10 favorite Spoon songs, which I think I had 13, and you said, "Do I write too many songs about longing?" And I said, you can never write too many songs about longing, because that's women love that. When a man sings about any sort of vulnerability or longing, we're in. Mm-hmm. We're completely in.
Yeah, I was wondering if that one song should go that direction, or if I should.
Always.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. I got one about that.
You do?
Yeah.
Can I hear it?
Can I use this?
Yeah, yeah.
This is exactly
what
my...
Is this new?
No.
If there's anyone
feeling that was gonna happen. Is it
if there's anything you want, come on back, 'cause it's all still here. I'll be in the back room drinking my half of the beer. And if you and me is so right, why is it the same thing every night? It's just a matter of time. It's almost measurable. Imagination ain't kind on us tonight. You're at your best when you got the guns turned 180 degrees. And finding out if it adds all up right. We go through all the same lines and sell out to appease, but go to sleep in a bed of lies. I made my own more than once or twice. And now time is my time. Time is my own and I feel so alive, yet feel so alone. Cause you know you're the one, and if that hasn't changed since you were 19 and still in school waiting on a light on the Buckman Sound Exchange.
So, is there a theme to the new record?
I haven't figured it out, if there is one. There probably is one lurking.
Now, when you write it, was there any external inspiration, or was it all just recent experience? Are you inspired by movies or art or books or...
I don't know. I usually just write down, you know, lines as they come to me when I'm not really in songwriting mode.
And ice then, cream.
Yeah, that was a funny line from real life. You know?
Yeah.
And then, you know, I got all these lines, and then some of them fit in some songs, and then you kind of just later figure out what's going on. I've always had a little more trouble saying, okay, I'm going to write a song about this. Here we go, you know? Mm-hmm. It's usually, you know, you get lucky with one or two lines, and then you go, okay, this can be about that.
Well, what about songwriters that reach a certain point and then feel like they have to speak, you know, the Messiah thing that happens after you've had some success, where you feel like it's your job to heal people with your music? I can think of a number of bands. There was one band in particular that were supposed to play Radio City after 9/11, and I was instant messaging with the singer, and I said, are you still going to do this? It's 2 days later. He said, New York needs me. Yes, they needed Travis to play at Radio City because that's what they needed. And he wasn't being ironic. He was being absolutely sincere because he felt like his music could heal New York. Has there ever been a point in your career where you think that you need to write something elevated to address the greater good?
No. You talking to me? You talking to me?
Any of you.
Well, I mean, you write, there's two parts of that, but you write hopefully to heal yourself. Mm-hmm. You have things you're trying to work out in your own head, and if something rings true to yourself and something means something to you, it probably will to other people, both lyrically and musically. If something touches you, you know, I think my line of what makes a great song, and this isn't always the case, but if it makes me cry when I'm writing it, yeah. I think I'm onto something. I got a good one going, you know. And if something, you know, you get that feeling, even if you don't have the words yet, where some combination of chords, you say, man, I got to stop for a second. This is kind of really bringing me down. Yeah. Like those are the ones you follow. I mean, you should feel something. And if you feel it and if you like it, then probably somebody else will. And it's hardest when you have to take on a big subject. The hardest things to write about in my life were actually 9/11, where I felt like being a New Yorker now and at that time, and feeling there was that need to be addressed. And eventually I found a way to do that. And also a few years later when one of my best friends was murdered, and I felt that I needed to... Both those times I felt if I don't address these things, like a death of a parent, which I've been through as well, you want to hit those, but they're so hard to hit those things and feel like you're hitting with some kind of honesty and maybe
it's
skirt around it.
About you excelling as well.
Well, yeah, and I totally hear that. And it is about the, you know, sort of healing yourself or revealing yourself to yourself. Mm-hmm. You know, we're in the, it's sort of this unconscious, for me at least, it's this unconscious act. Where you're sort of keep, like Britt said, you know, you're keeping notes as you go. Ideas sort of jump into your head, and then, you know, when a melody gets in there in the morning, and, you know, maybe it was something you heard in your sleep, or maybe it's something you heard on the radio, and it triggers a thing, and you put the copying paper over it, and you change it, and then the subject may or may not fit, given what you're doing with the music. The heavy subjects are hard because it's... You know, there's so many great, you know, songwriters who, you know, are known for protest music, and they know how to address the cause of the day or the concern of the day. And I sometimes I'm pretty ham-fisted in life, and that can be the big subjects are really like heavy gloves that you have to be careful with. Sometimes the best way to fit into the glove is when you're not thinking about it. At least for me, like if I sit down and go, I gotta write this song about this, then it's like, oh no. You know, it's just, I'm afraid that because I'm clumsy, I'm like a big bear at a picnic or something, I'm gonna wreck everything. So I try to be careful with my hands and stuff, so.
Jeremy, has, of your material, which many people have yet to hear, and it's quite stunning, is there anything that, song that comes to mind that you wrote to heal yourself?
Yeah, I have one which I don't know, might address kind of a larger issue, but again, I only write stuff that I give a shit about, and usually that, you know, is very, very personal to me, and sometimes that interacts with the larger world, often
well,
it
what
does,
about just even for yeah. you, where you're going some through some existential crisis, is there a song that you wrote that you found, can you play something that you find to be super cathartic?
Yeah.
Well, this got you from one state of mind to the next that's didn't necessarily solve a problem, but gave you insight into
sure,
something.
Sure, yeah. There was one song that I wrote when I was about 13 or 14. I had a youth pastor I really, really liked at the church I was at. And I remember one time he mentioned that he went into some kind of like a gay and lesbian chat room and said, you know, God created them Adam and Eve, not Adam and Steve. And we thought that was just the funniest thing we'd ever heard, and just kind of brilliant. And we laughed about it for, you know, a good while. And it's something that kind of just stuck with me for decades, and it made me just always wonder about. It always made me wonder about Steve, I guess. And well, I'll just play the song, I guess.
Walking in silence, the old woods are quiet. Nobody watching, just the trees. Evening sky passes, streams through the branches. Oh, kiss me under the moonlight, won't you, Steve? She hurt you so bad, you told me you wanted to die. If I'm your best friend, there's nothing that I wouldn't try. Ooh, ooh. Think what could happen, dare to imagine. So many possibilities. We may discover that we could be lovers. So kiss me under the moonlight, won't you, Steve? She hurt you so bad, you told me you wanted to die. Steve, I'm your best friend, there's nothing that I wouldn't try. Walking in silence, the old woods are quiet. Only our footsteps on the leaves. Things will get better, try to forget her and kiss me under the moonlight, won't you, Steve?
I like that. Very cool. So, Matthew.
Yeah.
Yesterday I asked you, and I didn't phrase it exactly this way. When you write songs, do you ever hear another voice besides your own singing them?
Oh,
Well, yes, in the same way that I don't know if a lot of other, maybe everyone does this, like you, when you're writing a song, you picture a place where you're singing it, and maybe it's like Assembly or the talent show or like that one club in town that you like, and you put it in a place. And I write songs and play in a band not because I feel like I was born to do that, but because I fell in love with records. And so I picture any number of voices singing it, just the voices of the things that have struck me. And you asked me yesterday who had my favorite voice in music. I didn't even know how to answer because I'm so album centric or song centric or band centric that I don't, the quality of the voice is totally overridden by everything else about the song, you know. And just like band names, you know, can seem, you know, The Who, maybe that seems silly, and then of course it's tremendous because they're tremendous. So I do picture other people singing.
Would you sing us something?
Sure.
I imagine your song sung in your voice.
Oh. that I can do. All right. Okay.
To make a mountain of your life is just a choice, but I never learned enough to listen to the voice that told me always love. Hate will get you every time, always love. Don't wait till the finish line. Slow demands come round, squeeze the air and keep the rest out. It helps to write it down, even when you then cross it out. But always love. Hate will get you every time. Always love. Even when you wanna fight self-directed lives, I wanna know what it'd be like to aim so high above any card that you get dealt you. But always love. Hate will get you every time. Always love. Hate will get you. And I've been held back by something. Yeah, you said to me quietly on the stairs, I've been held back by something. Yeah, you said to me quietly on the stairs. You said, hey, you good ones. Hey, you good ones. To make a mountain of your life is just a choice, but I never learned enough to listen to the voice that told me always love. Hate will get you every time. Always love. Hate will get you. And I've been held back by something. Yeah, you said to me quietly on the stairs, I've been held back by something. Yeah, you said to me quietly on the stairs. You said, hey, you good ones. Hey, you good ones. Hey, you good ones.
Thank you very much.
So that's the kind of thing where always love, hate will get you every time. I mean, that's another lyric that I think about a lot. It's something that, a guiding principle. Steve,
yeah,
hi.
Hi.
How's it going? we were talking about putting you on the spot and having you just show us the inner workings of your songwriting brain.
Yeah, I did agree to that, yeah.
You did agree to that. Thank you. I made Matthew do it last year.
Okay, okay.
So, any topics do we, is there anything we'd
want
Steve?
Oh, you're gonna lay a topic on me, all right, yeah.
Anything we'd want Steve to write a?
Wow, this is getting better.
I mean, if I were.
Anybody?
I would say me, but.
Karen.
So I wrote a song about you, but no, that's all right. How about Jewish.
Should I write a song about you? Oh,
that's... Jewish baseball players?
Well, I've done that. I've done that already. really, I have.
Jewish hockey players?
Nah, that's an anomaly. let me get a guitar in my hand. That didn't throw something at me.
How about the topic we were discussing? How everybody loves song. Women love songs about longing.
Yeah.
Can you muster something?
About longing.
About longing. Or in my case, sounds like whining.
Not longing, huh?
Something.
Really?
Try to bring down the things I remember from being 23 that might stick with me at this time. I try to take myself back to a place in my past I knew wouldn't last, but it hangs there in my mind. I was in New York City, lived in LA. I was trying to get by to the show the next day. I was staying on 44th Street at the Iroquois Hotel, wondering if sleep mattered, and I knew it didn't quite well, yeah. It didn't matter to me then, it matters more to me now. We had met some time before, some few months in Detroit before that, and time to bring up the score down in the Iroquois Hotel. I remember it well, not the Chelsea Hotel, but things resonate that way, you know. Nostalgia might be overrated, but it's all you got later, so you hang on, because time is elongated. It means more to you later as you think back. It is the pleasure and privilege of the older, elder statesmen among all of us. And sometimes the way you remember things later are different the way you felt them then. I'm sorry if I'm being obvious, we all know that. But it means more the further you get down the road. And by the way, and by the way, and by the way, that flop house of a hotel is now a luxury, deluxe, suite-based, expensive bar, and I don't hang out there anymore. I don't hang out there anymore. Don't hang out there anymore.
Wow.
So
that's longing, right?
Yeah. Well, what I remember is that's the first time I heard John Coltrane's Stereo Blues.
At that hotel.
At that hotel.
Yeah, yeah.
That's what I remember.
That only has one chord. As it goes on for a long time.
Yeah, well, it goes a long time.
I'm sorry about that too.
And rug burn, the other thing I remember. Matthew, you were...
Aren't you glad you came?
So, we were talking about Dream Syndicate, and
yeah.
Would you give a shot at Tell Me When It's Over?
It would be a thrill for me, yeah.
Great.
I'll do that.
Yeah, Matthew, over breakfast, or over actually after breakfast, showed me the riff of this song and asked if it was right. I think it is.
I never played it.
This is off the first Dream Syndicate record. And is everybody here a songwriter? Is that kind of, how many songwriters? Right, okay, yeah, us too.
And this is a song that I wrote when I was 21. It was on the first Dream Syndicate album. And part of the thing that, you know, I always say to songwriters, and I don't always follow this myself, but I say, you just got to write a ton of songs, because if you write, you know, 100 songs and 98 of them stink, you're still doing pretty well. And I try not to throw songs out when I realize I'm ripping off some other song, because probably you, by the end of the day, you won't be anymore. And this song was, I think, my attempt at the time to write a song like Save It For Later by the English Beat, which I was playing a lot back then. It sounds nothing like it, I don't think. Maybe it does. This song's called Tell Me When It's Over. Say it's a waste, oh, not to learn from mistakes. Yeah, it's really a shame. Oh, and the scars that you show, yeah, may as well be for show. Oh, it means nothing to me, and I really don't know, 'cause I don't wanna know. Oh yeah, tell me when it's over. Tell me when it's over. Let me know when it's done. Some kind of answer, yeah, but no question was posed. Oh, you got real imagination, man, and I really don't know, 'cause I don't wanna know. Oh yeah, tell me when it's over. Tell me when it's over. Let me know when it's done. Really don't know, man, I don't wanna know. Oh, tell me when it's over. Tell me when it's over. Let me know when it's done. I really don't know.
Oh yes, that part.
I really don't know. Save it for later. Save it for later. 'Cause I don't wanna know.
Thanks.
That was incredible.
That was really exciting for me.
So, whoa.
Almost busted a guitar. That's the graceful exit to it.
Can I quickly just tell just a quick story about Steve, and that is that I was a really big fan, and I was about to make our first record with Not a Surf, and I went to see Guided by Voices open for Urge Overkill at the Beacon Theater, and the top balcony was pretty empty, and I was just sitting up there with a friend, and I saw this guy sitting there, and I was like, oh my God, that's Steve Wynn. And I'm not good at going up to people. I sat next to Mitch Easter in a subway with a demo in my pocket, and he was reading the paper, and I just didn't want to bug him, you know? But I went up to Steve and introduced myself, and he was so gracious. And I said what I was doing, and you asked me for my address, and I sent you this tape that was going to turn into a record, and you wrote me a letter. And it was so moving. First of all, you liked it, which is incredibly validating for somebody who, you know, like a lot of people, I grew up like a floater, but also kind of an outsider, you know? And that meant a lot to me. And you also said, this is your record, and make sure to make it the way you want to, because you're the one who's going to care 20 years from now what it was like. And anyway, thank you for that. I really treasured it. And what's really strange is I'm not sure where it is, and that's because for a while it made me feel so cool to have gotten it that my relationship with it was weird, because it reminded me that I cared about that, and on another level I didn't want to care that I was cool, you know, but this letter felt so cool. So I would be very upset. It's in a box somewhere, but thank you so much for that. Yeah.
Jeremy, I mean, you're sitting among, I mean, you're new to this group, and welcome, and hope you'll remain a part of it. But do you have any questions or any observations about what we're discussing? Or
yeah, well, I'm very much enjoying just kind of soaking it all in. But I'm actually wondering about. I heard some snippets earlier, Bob. I think you were talking about. I heard a little thing about songwriting process. And I'm wondering how much of an everyday thing it is for everyone here. Like, are you very disciplined about it? Do you write every day? Is it kind of whenever you compile things and then it ends up coming out when it's time to write a record?
Do you write every day, Bob?
Do I write every day? Yeah. Some days I wake up very driven to write. You know, it's pretty much get up, make oatmeal, make coffee, make more coffee, get right into the room and just sit and start playing and see what happens. Stacks of words, you know, I can always just pull up some words from 3 weeks before or a week before and look at them, and melody meets words and you do these things. I try to do it every day. I mean, it's, you know, there's so many adages about, you know, it's not work if you love doing it. I think it's what all of us do day in and day out with our lives. You know, we talk about our work and we play our work for people and stuff, but ultimately it's that getting up in the morning and just really applying yourself and being very grateful that you get to do this with your life, and you don't let it rust. You know, you have to shake it off every day. And you know, some days it's like, you know, 16 bars of nothing. You know, other days it's like the songs that you'll play till they put you in the ground. It's, you have no idea what's going to happen, and if you don't know if you don't do it. So I think it's all about constant attention to the craft.
So you have a new record coming out, right?
Yep.
Would you maybe do a new song?
Yeah, sure. I played that song Hardly Getting Over It earlier and talked a little bit. You know, it's that sort of first touch on mortality, which, you know, at 25 nobody wants to talk about. And then, you know, fast forward, and you know, when you start to lose people in your life, you know, you lose close friends, you lose a parent, you lose the people that, you know, brought music to you, and you have to, you know, for me, I had to stop and think about, well, I delayed the thinking about it, but when I finally started thinking about it and what it all meant, again, it was trying to put that glove on as gracefully as possible, and I'm not sure I did it, but I think I got a really good song out of it, so... Let me try to play it without pulling my head off.
Okay. I may cry. Matthew, will you cry if I cry?
I'll join you. I'm here for you.
What's it called, Bob?
It's called The War. The War. If I hit this hard, it'll be okay?
Oh, yeah, go for it.
Absolutely.
And all these songs I write for you tear me up, it's not hard to do. Listen to my voice, only weapon I kept from the war. From the war. From the war. From the war. And I can soothe every ailment you endure. And I can see into the future. almost assured. I don't have a choice. It's the only life I know after the war. After the war. Out from the war. From the war. And everything we made reduced to dust. You were the one who taught me most. Carry your remains, your emblem and your name. Nothing left will ever be the same. This war we fought was violent and long. The weeks turned into years, but we kept on keeping on. They're ringing in my brain. Is what remains. Is what remains. Is what remains. This war has worn me down. Broken dreams and a hole in the ground. Don't give up and don't give in.
Holy shit. I feel like we should
see
be doing...
See how I did that with the answer?
Yeah, and it was good. And then the pause, which is always effective in songs. So we have 2 minutes left. Should we write a rock opera? What do you think?
It's going to be short.
I mean, any... We have 2 minutes...
Questions.
Yeah, 2 minutes of questions. Let's go.
Who's your favorite songwriter?
For me, it's too obvious, but being obvious is okay sometimes. Bob Dylan is, I think, underrated, amazingly enough. He's written so many great songs.
Townsend, Richard Thompson, Lennon McCartney, Kevin Shields.
Mm-hmm. All of those, plus Dee Dee Ramone. Ian McCulloch early on, Black Francis. So many, the three guys in Teenage Fan Club who write songs, Roger McGuinn, and weirdly it's true, Dylan is underrated, freakish as that is to say.
Yeah, that's a hard one. I usually just throw out Prince and John Lennon, maybe Robert Smith.
Remember when I introduced you to Robert Smith?
Yeah, I do.
You couldn't talk.
Oh, I'll just add Stephen Merritt on that list for me.
Jimmy Webb for me. Jimmy Webb.
Oh, yeah.
Years and years and years ago, I asked Bob to cover Wichita Lineman.
Yeah.
What were the first? Can you just sing a? I just want to hear
for the county.
That's it. That's all. That's the best song.
The beauty of it is that the list is endless. It really is. Of songwriters that I'm sure I'll discover 100 more before I die that I adore.
Is a question back there?
Yes, how's it going? What are some things a songwriter should consider when crafting a song? Besides just putting pen to paper, what are some things that they should do before they write the first line?
Well, it's kind of mindset, you know, this thing where it only takes 10 minutes to write a song, but to find that 10 minutes is incredibly difficult, or can be. Maybe you could just get lucky, but make sure you're not thinking too much about what other people are going to think about it, but really concentrating on what you think about it, I think.
A lot of it is setting too, trying to create a space, you know, in your home or wherever you like to do your work, where you feel safe and you can shut everything else off and not get affected by the outside world or what's happening at that moment with your friends in social media. It's really, you got to put that stuff away and really let yourself be in the moment and be in a safe place and again, just not worry about what you're about to do. You know, because you don't know. It just happens.
Yeah, I'm with that. Being fearless is the best thing for any kind of writing or making music. Just not caring. And it's always the things that seem the most wrong at the time that end up being your favorite things later on.
Thank you. Next.
Thank you.
One other? You here? That's a good question.
Yeah.
Britt?
I almost invariably think about myself having that same conversation with someone that I feel that way about.
Like Robert Smith.
I mean, unless it's a really bad day or something like that, I try to channel that, you know, and respond with appreciation, you know.
Yeah, it's the same thing.
Do you ever feel, though, like one of the things that when I first met Alex Chilton, he said, we had dinner, and I was being Uber fan, and he said, he looked up from his margarita, and he said, you know, there's no glory in being a cult artist. But it's a living, right?
Actually, there's a lot of glory, and there's a lot of glory in touching people in any way at all. There's no, it's not, I think, look, and all of us have been at various points in our lives where we want to reach more people or be more universal. But the end of the day is, first of all, we've all been doing it for a long time. We're still doing it. And that's you know, victory. It's, you know, and the fact that you actually reach people, all my favorite artists were cult artists. The bands I loved, like Big Star, like the Velvet Underground, like, you know, the Modern Lovers, like the Gun Club, the bands who really, they just reached me in some incredibly profound way, still do, but definitely when I was younger, so that the fact that we've all had a chance to do the same thing and it reached anybody, one person, five people, whatever, it's great, it's a great feeling. And we, you know, like Britt said, we know what that feels like, so it's a great thing to hear.
Okay, we have to wrap this up. Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you, Karen, for having us. It's been really fun, thank you.
Thanks, Karen.
Really.